Good evening, esteemed members of the audience, ladies and gentlemen. Welcome to this session of the webinar series on echocardiography organized by Indian Academy of Echocardiography. I am Dr. Soumitra Kumar, acting as moderator for today's symposium. And with me today is a very senior, distinguished cardiologist of the country, Professor S. Shanmugasundaram. Who has been known to me for many years. He's a dear friend and very esteemed colleague of mine. He really speaking doesn't need any introduction, but for the sake of convention, I'll speak a few words about him. He's a former professor of cardiology at the Stanley and Madras Medical Colleges, Chennai. He's currently emeritus professor of cardiology, Tamil Nadu, Dr. MGR Medical University. He has been a past president of Indian Academy of Echocardiography. He is a consultant at Bill Roth Hospital, Chennai, and a founder trustee of ASCERT, Associates for Cardiology Education and Research in Tamil Nadu. He is going to speak on hypertrophic cardiomyopathy and its variants. So over to Professor Shanmugasundaram. Please proceed, Professor.
Thank you, Dr. Soumitra Kumar. It's a pleasure and privilege to deliver this lecture in IAE webinar, particularly when my close friend, Dr. Soumitra Kumar, is going to moderate it. Let me share the slide now. Nearly 30 years ago, Dr. Soumitra Kumar, I think slides are visible.
Yeah, slides are visible and you are perfectly audible. Please proceed.
Thank you. Nearly 30 years ago, Dr. Parashar gave me this responsibility of talking on hypertrophic cardiomyopathy. It's one of the IAE meetings. It is this privilege is given to me again. Now you would realize that any imaging modality is useful for diagnosis of the disease. But hypertrophic cardiomyopathy is one condition where imaging not only helps in establishing the diagnosis, it also has helped clinicians to understand the entire disease process. Very aptly chosen topic for me, hypertrophic cardiomyopathy and its variants. Something like the popular saying, the only constant thing in life is change. The only consistent fact about hypertrophic cardiomyopathy is that it is very heterogeneous. Right from the start till the end, echocardiography plays a role in managing a patient with hypertrophic cardiomyopathy, in establishing the diagnosis, locating the hypertrophy, pattern of hypertrophy, magnitude of LVH, hemodynamics, namely the presence of outflow obstruction, mitral regurgitation, diastolic dysfunction, then guiding the therapy, particularly the invasive therapies, following up the patient, as well as prognosticate a patient with hypertrophic cardiomyopathy, particularly in choosing a patient for advanced therapies like ICD. Hypertrophic cardiomyopathy, by definition, is the presence of hypertrophy of left ventricle plus or minus right ventricle in the absence of a cardiac or systemic condition that can account for that amount of evident hypertrophy. So we need to rule out secondary causes of left ventricular hypertrophy, the common causes being hypertension, aortic stenosis, and adaptive hypertrophy of athlete's heart. And also, we need to exclude simulating conditions, the so-called HCM phenotypes. I have chosen to change asymmetric septal hypertrophy to asymmetrical hypertrophy for defining this disease, because the disease can involve any segment of left ventricle. Even it could spare the septum and involve the anterolateral wall. So it is defined as a wall thickness of the hypertrophied segment exceeding 15 millimeter, with the ratio of hypertrophied to unaffected wall exceeding 1.3. For family screening, the absolute wall thickness cutoff is kept at 13 millimeter. And for hypertensives, the ratio is kept at 1.5 to improve the specificity of diagnosis. If you look at the pattern of hypertrophy in hypertrophic cardiomyopathy, no pattern is typical or classical of hypertrophic cardiomyopathy. Any segment of LV or RV can get involved in the disease. It is commonly the anterior septum, the adjoining LV anterior wall, anterolateral wall, and the inferior septum. These are the segments which are commonly involved in the disease process. But if you look at this slide, which shows the varied presentation of the hypertrophy process, you will realize that hypertrophic cardiomyopathy is really heterogeneous disease. Here, only the anterior septum. Here, only the inferior septum is involved. You get septal involvement plus lateral wall involvement, sparing the anterior wall and inferior wall. This non-contiguous involvement of hypertrophy is very classic of hypertrophic cardiomyopathy. Then an example which shows anterior, inferior septum and inferior wall. Here you have involvement of LV inferior wall and infralateral wall sparing the septum. And we have somebody who manifests hypertrophy of anterior IVS, anterolateral wall, and some part of infralateral wall. So any segment of LV can get involved in the disease process. By looking at the shape of LV cavity or the left side of the septum, the disease is classified into four phenotypes based on echocardiography. One is reverse septum or catenoid septum. It is very common in young individuals. Gene positivity is very high in this type. Nearly 80% of them will definitely show some gene mutations. Next comes neutral septum or the flat septum. The gene variants or gene mutations are identified in roughly 50% of them. Then comes sigmoid septum, where the basal part of the septum is hypertrophied, imparting an S-shaped curvature to the interventricular septum. Then comes apical variant. It constitutes less than 10% of people. The process of hypertrophy gets rotated counterclockwise from base to apex. At the level of mitral valve, it is the anterior septum. At the level of papillary muscle, it is the inferior septum. And near the apex, it is the inferior wall. So this is known as spiral hypertrophic cardiomyopathy. Though HCM is a sarcomere disease, non-sarcomeric structures like mitral valve, the mitral valve apparatus may get involved in the disease. They are also inherited along with hypertrophy. And it is interesting to know that people who have positive genes but have not yet manifested hypertrophy can manifest this mitral valve abnormalities. What are the abnormalities that are described? Other structural abnormalities apart from hypertrophy, longer mitral valve leaflets. Normally, it's about a 24 millimeter anterior mitral leaflet. It may be long as 34 millimeter. In one of my patients, it's just measured about 4. And we can get a direct attachment of papillary muscle to the mitral valve. You can get an apical basal septal bundle, which is supposed to occur in nearly 1/3. The papillary muscle, particularly the anterolateral papillary muscle, is hypertrophied, no surprise, but it gets displaced anteriorly and apically in some of the patients. And it may be bifid like, which is shown in this illustration. One more structural abnormalities which is coming to recognition is the presence of mitral aortic discontinuity. The discontinuity is not very significant. It is to the extent of about 2 to 3 millimeter only. But it might contribute to the relatively long mitral leaflet and its laxity. Surgeons have observed this finding in nearly 25% of people with hypertrophic cardiomyopathy. This is not very great picture, but you know, you can see a thick focal spot between the hinge point of the anterior mitral leaflet and the aortic leaflet. This could be a subtle form of mitral aortic discontinuity. Next comes is the documentation of obstruction in hypertrophic cardiomyopathy. As I mentioned in the beginning, the echocardiographic particularly, or the imaging modalities, have improved our understanding about the disease. I could recall early 80s, there were heated discussions about whether there is real obstruction in LV, or could it be a catheter entrapment or catheter whip artifact, which is causing the so-called gradient in invasive studies. With the two-dimensional echo, particularly with the Doppler echocardiography, we have come to understand that there is real obstruction, and resting obstruction is observed in nearly 1/3, provocable obstruction in another 1/3, and 1/3 of patients with HCM do not manifest hypertrophic cardiomyopathy. It is non-obstructive HCM. If you look at the outlook of patients, people with the provocable obstruction as well as resting obstruction do not fare well when compared to people with no obstruction. So it is very essential to document the presence of obstruction, which is caused typically by the systolic anterior motion of anterior mitral leaflet and its the cardia, which is attached to the anterior mitral leaflet. Previously, it was felt that the venturi forces lift the anterior mitral leaflet to the basal septum, but we know based on imaging studies that it is the drag force that lifts the mitral leaflet towards the interventricular septum, and it is responsible for narrowing the LV outflow tract. So the obstruction is likely to be a dynamic one, starts little later in systole, and Doppler may show an inflection point followed by a dagger-shaped continuous wave Doppler signal, which is very typical of dynamic muscular obstruction of hypertrophic cardiomyopathy. In contrast, fixed obstruction in subaortic membrane as well as valvular aortic stenosis, it will be parabolic like this. If you think that MOD might be useful in some disease situations, apart from constrictive pericarditis, MOD plays an important role in studying hypertrophic cardiomyopathy. Because of its temporal resolution, you can document the systolic anterior motion very nicely. Longer the opposition of anterior mitral leaflet with the septum, more severe would be the obstruction. Because of the obstruction which occurs in early systole, there may be early systolic closure followed by reopening of the aortic valve in MOD echocardiography. There are certain other causes of systolic anterior motion, HCM, any hyperadrenergic state, LV hypertrophy, for example, secondary to hypertension with a small LV cavity, stress cardiomyopathy, anteroapical myocardial infarction, dobutamine infusion, post-valve replacement, etc. For some time in the past, people were talking about pseudo-SAM, but with 2D and Doppler, it's no longer an important thing to rule out. To just as recalling the memory of the past MOD studies on hypertrophic cardiomyopathy and its simulating conditions, pseudo-SAM is caused by slack cardiac and mitral leaflet. Excessive leaflet movement could cause a simulating movement of mitral apparatus. But when compared to the true SAM, where the contact with the septum occurs quite early in systole, this moves along with posterior wall of the LV. And here the peak occurs well ahead of left ventricular posterior wall peak movement. Not only that, it returns to baseline quite earlier than mitral valve movement, but here it goes up to the mitral valve movement. Pseudo-SAM occurs in conditions like mitral valve prolapse, pericardial effusion, systemic hypertension, etc. But now, look at the way in which SAM occurs in 3D. The 3D modeling have nicely confirmed the way in which systolic anterior motion occurs. The middle segment of anterior mitral leaflet gets lifted up, something like the tongue projection into the LV outflow tract, causing outflow obstruction. End phase, the mitral valve modeling will look like the smiling dolphin. It is known as smiling dolphin sign. Doppler documents the magnitude of obstruction. Anything more than 30 millimeter peak gradient is considered as significant. 50 millimeter and more is chosen for considering invasive therapies or septal reduction therapies when the patient continues to be symptomatic despite optimal medical therapy. There is wide variability of the gradients encountered in practice. It may be as high as 200 or 250 millimeter of mercury. You can see how the post extrasystolic phase you can get increased gradient. We need to realize that even in people who do not manifest resting obstruction, it is an important step to provoke obstruction in the non-invasive laboratory. Why should we do that? Somebody with no resting obstruction but very symptomatic, significant hypertrophy of basal septum, to decide whether he is a candidate for septal reduction therapy or not, we need to document at least provocable obstruction. Not only that, in those who do not manifest symptoms, occurrence of provocable obstruction tells you that the patient is likely to be symptomatic in the near future. These are the two examples of obstruction being provoked by a simple Valsalva maneuver. But for performing the Valsalva maneuver, we need the patient to realize the method of doing it and the cooperation from the patient. Here is an example where there is no resting obstruction. It becomes nearly 90 millimeter gradient with the Valsalva. Here, resting obstruction of with a peak velocity of 4.5. There are a lot of maneuvers which can provoke the obstruction. Anything which lower the preload, lower the afterload, and increase the contractility will increase the gradient. Dobutamine, even in normal individual, it can provoke dynamic gradient, so it should be avoided. Nitroglycerin at times can result in occurrence of severe systolic anterior motion with cardiovascular collapse. So we depend on either Valsalva or physical exercise to provoke gradient. When compared to the Valsalva maneuver, upright exercise seems to be the best and the most physiological method. Nearly 50% of the people who do not manifest obstruction with Valsalva maneuver may do so with physical exercise. Upright exercise is good enough, and you can take your time, terminate the exercise once the target is reached. The patient becomes symptomatic, make him lie down. Soon after completion of exercise, if you record the gradient, it is as good as the gradient recorded in erect posture at the peak exercise. A difficult process. Possible is very essential. And interestingly, the provocation in postprandial state may also be considered. This is a small, simple study, but this brings out the fact that if you do a Valsalva maneuver in post-meal state, you will be able to induce obstruction in nearly 74% of people, among those who did not manifest resting obstruction. So this method can also be tried in those people who are symptomatic, but they do not manifest gradient with simple in fasting state. It is not uncommon to mild to moderate hypertrophy, but with a very marked example is this, a very long mitral leaflet, lax leaflet, could be partly responsible for the occurrence of severe LV outflow obstruction in spite of mild to moderate hypertrophy of interventricular septum. But whenever you see a significant outflow obstruction with mild to moderate hypertrophy, I may define it as anything less than 18 millimeter, mild to moderate LVH with obstruction, rule out this anatomical malformation where the papillary muscle is directly attached to the anterior mitral leaflet, which can cause both mid-cavity obstruction as well as LV outflow obstruction. On the contrary, you may get to see somebody with significant hypertrophy, SAM in very good looking SAM in mitral, in M mode, but with no gradient at rest as well as provoking manoeuvres. If you carefully look at it, it is the caudae that undergoes SAM rather than the anterior mitral leaflet. Obviously, a slender caudae can give a nice vivid appearance of SAM in M mode, but may not be good enough to cause LV outflow obstruction. Another site where cavity obstruction can occur is the mid part of the cavity. In this example, we could see the mid part of the cavity is totally getting obliterated in systole, inducing a gradient in the body of left ventricle. This also will behave like LV outflow obstruction. It is dynamic, starts little later and reaches peak in late systole, and Valsalva maneuver can increase the gradient even in people with the mid cavity obstruction. In this example, we get to see a notch in the mid cavity gradient continuous wave Doppler signal. It could mean either an interruption of ejection followed by continued ejection in late systole, or it could be a paradoxical flow from the apex. You see some color flow here in the apex. This could mean that there is a paradoxical flow which occurs during the isovolemic relaxation phase. Now, why should mid cavity get obstructed? The typical anatomical requirements for mid cavity obstruction is a large papillary muscle which opposes with the maximally hypertrophied mid part of the interventricular septum. As I have already mentioned, that anomalous attachment of anterolateral papillary muscle to anterior mitral leaflets directly without interposed caudae can also cause mid cavity as well as LV outflow obstruction. A subtype of apical cardiomyopathy can also present with mid cavity obstruction. When the cavity gets obstructed in the mid cavity, mid portion, you get to see two chambers. So one is the proximal chamber and another one is the apical or the distal chamber, giving rise to a typical hourglass shaped LV cavity. The importance of recognizing this is whenever you get a hourglass configuration, we know that the apical cavity undergoes isovolemic contraction because it is not able to eject the blood beyond the site of obstruction in mid cavity. So this would be the reason for occurrence of apical MI as well as progression to aneurysm formation. This is an example of non-obstructive hypertrophic cardiomyopathy, huge hypertrophy of septum, but with no gradient at rest and with provocation. And this group of people, it is the diastolic dysfunction that determines the presence of symptoms. Apical cardiomyopathy deserves a special mention and a detailed discussion, because now we realize that apical cardiomyopathy is no longer a benign disease. It's defined as the documentation of hypertrophy of the apical portion, apical septum, as well as the apical lateral and inferior wall, distal to the papillary muscles. Wall thickness of 15 millimeter and the ratio is also used here. But if you look at the thickness of LV in a normal individual, it is close to 5-6 millimeter. So some authors prefer to use lower degree of hypertrophy to identify apical cardiomyopathy. Say, for example, 12 millimeter, 13 millimeter is also taken. Different types. One is pure variety. Hypertrophy is confined only to the apex, Japanese variety, and hypertrophy affecting the other components of LV and predominantly affecting the apex, it's the oriental variety. We can see some examples here. It is the pure variety of apical cardiomyopathy, a quite innocuous looking long axis view, but if you look at the apical four chamber and two chamber view, you can get to see the significant hypertrophy of the apex, the typical spade shaped cavity configuration in diastole as well as in systole. Now, the second example tells you that this is a mixed variety where the mid part of the septum and the lateral wall is hypertrophied, but with predominant hypertrophy of the LV apex. You know, 2D strain may show decreased strain involving the apical components. I would like the listeners to carefully search for apical cardiomyopathy. Quite often we are likely to miss it. When ECG is suggestive, I think you should spend time doing apical four-chamber view as well as apical two-chamber view to identify apical cardiomyopathy. This is another example of a mixed variety of apical cardiomyopathy. Hypertrophy elsewhere, LV outflow gradient, MR is there. But if you look at the maximum hypertrophy, this seems to be involving the apical lateral segment. So any type of combination of apical cardiomyopathy can be encountered. Multimodal modality of imaging can throw additional lights when echocardiography fails to identify apical cardiomyopathy. Typically, cardiac magnetic resonance can easily identify the apical cardiomyopathy, the presence of LV aneurysm or outpouching from apical segments can be identified by MRI. SPECT, an interesting image, so-called solar map, is created because of increased uptake of nuclear material in the apical segments. And with exercise, there will be inducible ischemia in the apical segments. The apex, the hypertrophied apex may get totally obliterated, or there may be a small slit, or there may be a small outpouching, or it may progress to form an aneurysm. An apical aneurysm in apical cardiomyopathy, whether it is in the pure variety, as well as in the mixed or mid-cavity obstruction variant, it carries a poor prognosis. As I mentioned in the beginning, ACM is no longer a benign disease. 10% annual occurrence of significant arrhythmias, sudden cardiac death, systemic embolism, and heart failure. What are the risk predictors? Younger age of presentation, class 3 to 4 functional status, presence of apical outpouching or aneurysm, demonstration of scarring of the LV apex, the occurrence of mid-cavity gradient with the paradoxical diastolic flow will also identify somebody who is at risk of developing cardiac events. Now comes the other variety, the so-called sigmoid hypertrophic cardiomyopathy, which is, I think it's poorly understood. At times I have found it difficult to differentiate from the basal septal hypertrophy of elderly. But if the hypertrophy is significant and if you are able to, identify the typical dagger-shaped gradient, one can diagnose the sigmoid HCM confidently. There are certain differentiating features between sigmoidal HCM and the elderly septal bulge, which is encountered quite often in hypertensives. The hypertrophy is lesser when compared to HCM. The angle between the interventricular septum and the anterior wall of the aorta is more acute in elderly septal bulge. The late gadolinium enhancement in CMR is positive in HCM, but not in septal bulge of elderly. Family history is likely to help you to differentiate between the two conditions. Now, this is what I mentioned about documenting paradoxical flow. This is a mid-cavity obstruction, which is nicely seen. You could see a typical LV apical aneurysm, which is dyskinetic in systole. But look at carefully the color flow. You could see some out of phase, color flow near the mid cavity. If you place your, pulse Doppler sample volume here, this is the pattern which I got. The forward flow, the flow from the apex towards the mitral valve, seems to occur during early and mid systole, but starting from late systole to entire diastole, except atrial systole, the flow seems to occur from apex to the base. In diastole, normally what we expect is flow from mitral valve to apex. Here, you see predominant flow in diastole is from apex to base. This is the typical paradoxical flow, which tells you that you are dealing with a high-risk situation. Whenever you see somebody with aneurysm, with a gradient here, and paradoxical flow, it identifies high-risk category of apical cardiomyopathy. One other Doppler signal which is encountered in hypertrophic obstructive cardiomyopathy is the bifid Doppler pattern. You can see the bifid Doppler pattern is superimposed on the LV outflow gradient here. If you keep the sample pulse Doppler sample volume just proximal to the LV outflow mouth, you can separately identify the notched signals here. This is nothing but the LV outflow gets, when the flow gets accelerated when the SAM occurs at the peak and the continuous wave Doppler reaches the peak, there is deceleration followed by re-acceleration. This is known as the lobster claw pattern of LV outflow signals, which is typically obtained at the proximal part of the LV outflow in people with LV outflow obstruction. Mitral regurgitation occurs in people with LV outflow obstruction. SAM results in disengagement of anterior mitral leaflet from the posterior mitral leaflet, which results in a posterolaterally directed mitral regurgitation jet. The occurrence of turbulent signals in the LV outflow and in the left atrium seems to simulate the bird's wings. Seagull appearance is the name given to this color Doppler signal. At times, it may cause confusion with the outflow gradients. You can have a pattern like this where the outflow gradient, the typical dagger-shaped signal, is superimposed on the mitral regurgitation signal. The line diagram is here to understand. Remember, mitral regurgitation signal starts quite early in systole, as soon as the diastole starts, even before the ventricular ejection occurs. But the outflow gradient signal starts a little later and reaches peak in end systole, in contrast to mitral regurgitation signal, which reaches peak in mid systole. Typically, it is a posterolateral jet. Whenever it is severe or central, we need to rule out other causes except causes other than SAM of mitral valve, namely annulus calcification, myxomatous mitral valve, caudal rupture, anomalous cardia, or papillary muscle attachment, etc. Why should the jet be directed posterolaterally? End systolic freeze frame in apical four-chamber view and the long axis view, mitral leaflets form a funnel. The mouth of the funnel is directed posteriorly and laterally. That is how the posterolateral jet of mitral regurgitation is supposed to occur when there is a systolic anterior motion of mitral valve. Whenever there is a central jet, we are expected to rule out other mitral valve pathologies. But in this study, when they looked at people with a non-posterior jet, nearly 115 people, only 23 had intrinsic mitral valve abnormalities. So it is not a surprise to encounter SAM-inducing central jet. But remember, I'm not saying that central jet is a common feature of SAM-induced MR, but whenever you get a central MR, it is a responsibility to rule out intrinsic mitral valve pathology. But if you are not able to rule out, you need not get surprised. The mechanism which is offered for central jet in SAM-induced MR is, look at the funnel of SAM. This asymmetrical funnel directs the jet posterolaterally. But if the posterior mitral leaflet is as long as anterior mitral leaflet or much shorter, the funnel is not now directed towards the lateral aspect or the posterior aspect, it is directed towards the roof, resulting in a central jet. These are the three examples from my series, where typical SAM is documented, but you get to see mild, moderate, and severe central mitral regurgitation jet. Then comes the question of right ventricle getting involved in disease. as many as 30-40% of the people will have right ventricular involvement, quite often non-obstructive. You document only the hypertrophy of the RV free wall. At times, you may document obstruction either at the RV outflow or in the body. You know, example is this turbulent jet is encountered here near the apex, and a gradient of about 38 millimeter of mercury could be recorded. It is not uncommon to see the intramyocardial coronary flow velocities, as you see in this individual. At least, you know, two signals are seen within the hypertrophied septum. When I place the pulse Doppler sample volume, I could record markedly increased systolic flow velocity with diastolic flow velocities. But generally, when the coronary artery gets compressed, systolic flow gets obliterated or even be paradoxical, directed towards the opposite direction. Now, one of the worst complications of hypertrophic cardiomyopathy, that is progression of HCM phenotype to DCM phenotype, the hypertrophy regresses, they get into a typical DCM phenotype. I had two patients of mine who manifested non-obstructive hypertrophic cardiomyopathy to start with. Within a period of 5 to 7 years, they progressed to this stage. In a large series of about 6,793 patients with hypertrophic cardiomyopathy followed for more than 9 years, 8% manifested this phenomenon, and at least 1/3 of them died within the 8 years of follow-up. That is the worst prognosis of this phenotype. ECHO can also guide you to predict who are the persons who can, who are likely to develop this DCM phenotype. Whenever you get to see somebody with, normally we expect a small LV in HCM. If you get to see a larger LV, we get to see a borderline ejection fraction. We get generally supernormal EF. We get to see 50-60% EF. Do a CMR, the late gadolinium enhancement is occupying more than 20% of the total myocardium. Or sometimes, if you do a genetic study, thin filament mutations can tell you that these are the individuals who are likely to develop this complication. The systolic function as estimated by EF is supranormal because when the long axis function is declining, as documented by the tissue Doppler in most of the patients with HCM, even people with mild HCM will show reduction of longitudinal function of the left ventricle. It is compensated by augmented radial contraction. That's why you get to see supernormal EF in people with HCM. When we see marked reduction of tissue Doppler velocities, for example, systolic velocity of less than 4 cm, tells you that these are the individuals who are likely to progress to LV systolic dysfunction and develop complications. Similarly, dyssynchrony, intraventricular dyssynchrony exceeding 45 milliseconds tells you that the arrhythmic events are more. 2D strain, like the heterogeneity of anatomy and physiology, even the 2D strain is quite heterogeneous. Predictable occurrence of reduction of 2D strain in various segments. Same individuals are subjected to CMR, there is an initial impression that marked reduction, focal reduction of longitudinal strain in some of the segments could match with fibrosis documented by CMR, particularly when the focal or the segmental strain is worse than 12.5%. People, with non-obstructive and labile obstructive and obstructive generally have lesser restraint, and with exercise they don't reach the normal values. So exercise induced strain values may also help you to identify high risk individuals. Diastolic dysfunction is the next hemodynamic abnormality. It is almost universal in all, but no single variable is predictive of increased LV filling pressures. A comprehensive approach is essential. E by E dash, left atrial volume index, pulmonary venous atrial reversal minus A duration of more than 30 milliseconds, and TR velocity of more than 2.8 meters per second. If more than 50% of the variables is present, you are sure that the diastolic dysfunction exists and the left atrial pressure is high in that individual. But we need to specifically look for this restrictive phenotype of HCM, which is another marked by atrial enlargement, small ventricle, hypertrophied ventricle, a steep deceleration of transmitral E velocity. Whenever you see a restrictive physiology in hypertrophic cardiomyopathy, they are not going to do well. Six-fold increase in end-stage heart failure, sudden cardiac death, and requirement of ICD occurs in this category of people. This is another patient of mine, a young female doctor, very symptomatic, even few steps, if she walks, she gets feeling markedly, there is any cavity on the right side, in the right ventricle. And this could result in markedly elevated, diastolic pressure, atrial filling pressure, explaining inferior vena cava. The transmitral Doppler, not the usual restrictive pattern, but another interesting observation is seen. You could see a small E wave, maybe relaxation abnormality. Atrium tries to compensate by increasing the booster function, but its function is terminated quite earlier on. Even before the end of diastole, the atrial contraction seems to come to an end. This tells us that LV end-diastolic pressure is grossly elevated in this restrictive phenotype. Now, the question of studying left atrium in hypertrophic cardiomyopathy, an important step. Left atrium can get affected either because of mitral regurgitation. The LEA parameters could predict complications. LEA AP diameter more than 45 millimeter or volume index more than 40 ml per meter square, LEA emptying fraction less than 37% could predict the occurrence of atrial fibrillation. If you look at the strain, all the three strains of LEA, the reservoir phase, the conduit phase, and the contraction phase, all three phases, the strain is markedly reduced when compared to controls. And whenever the LEA strain, particularly the reservoir phase strain, is less than 17%, it could predict ventricular arrhythmias and sudden cardiac death. Contrast echocardiography, whenever you are not able to identify the septum, contrast echocardiography might be of some use. It opacifies RV and LV. You can identify the true thickness of the intraventricular septum. Not only that, even the free wall thickness can be accurately measured. Another place where the contrast echo will be of help is to identify which septal artery needs to be attended to during septal reduction therapy by looking at the way the segment which undergoes opacification with your contrast injection. Another condition, look at, this is obtained from the literature. Apical four-chamber view routine study does not even raise a suspicion about apical cardiomyopathy, but look at what happens with contrast study, the typical spade-shaped appearance of LV cavity. Because of the very good images in most of the individuals with HCM, we hardly need transesophageal echo. The mechanism and the level of obstruction, TE might be of use, but anyway, during septal reduction therapies, namely alcohol and septal ablation, as well as intraoperative procedure for myectomy, visual echocardiography is very essential. These are the two examples of my patients who had undergone septal myectomy. Post-procedure study, you can see the scooped out septum at the base. The LV mass itself has regressed within a few months of resecting a small segment of LV at the base. Now, coming to cardiac MRI, investigating a patient with a hypertrophic cardiomyopathy is definitely incomplete. Without doing a cardiac MRI, I will go to the extent of saying that all individuals with proven and suspected HCM should undergo cardiac MRI. Because of the imaging capabilities, you can detect hypertrophy in blind spots. Accurate measurement of hypertrophy is very useful. It can delineate apical aneurysm, quantify fibrosis, and recently T1 mapping is helpful to identify the interstitial fibrosis in the context of increased extracellular volume. Look at this view. You are sure where the LV endocardium is. But if you ask me to identify where the RV surface of septum is, marks may get superimposed on the septum, resulting in false estimation of septal thickness. Here is a situation where cardiac MRI would be of profound use, because septal thickness or segmental thickness of more than 30 millimeter is often used for choosing people who are ICD therapy. So it's very essential to document the true thickness of LV. The occurrence of focal hypertrophy here, hypertrophy involving the entire interventricular septum. So you can get a very detailed information about the anatomy as well as the physiology. Here is an example of apical cardiomyopathy. Here you see a nice aneurysm. The aneurysm shows extensive scarring. CRIPS is another newly recognized finding in cardiac MRI in people with HCM, not only HCM. When you screen family members of HCM, even before hypertrophy starts, infralateral CRIPS seems to identify gene positive people. So it is going to be very useful in surveying family members of HCM proband. Now, coming to risk prediction, how does imaging help? Recent ACC guidelines, any one of the risk predictors is good enough to myopathy or mid-cavity obstruction with LV aneurysm, it's turning to DCM phenotype, EF of less than 50%, and documentation of large amount of scar in cardiac MRI. So imaging goes a long way in risk prediction for choosing people with people who are likely to encounter sudden cardiac death. Here is an example. There is a massive hypertrophy. The septum measures 36 millimeter. And the presence of LV apical aneurysm, particularly when you document scar here, extensive scarring in LGE, MRI, say anything which exceeds 20 millimeter has much worse outlook. The strain, 2D strain, is coming close to cardiac MRI in identifying people who are at high risk. GLS of less than or worse than 10.7%, mechanical dispersion of more than 60, and if more than three segments show lower segmental strain, they could predict occurrence of ventricular arrhythmias and propensity to sudden cardiac death. The last responsibility is to rule out simulating conditions. Thickened wall is not sine qua non of hypertrophic cardiomyopathy. Nearly 5 to 10% of people who present with echocardiographic picture of HCM may have other reasons, both genetic as well as acquired disease conditions. Athlete's heart is one which needs to be differentiated, but if somebody gives a history of participation in sports and isometric exercise for a very long period, and there are number of points. What are the points which help you to document hypertrophic cardiomyopathy, focal hypertrophy, marked hypertrophy, transition between hypertrophied and non-hypertrophied segment if it is abrupt, small LV cavity, much larger LA, diastolic function abnormalities, abnormal strain, presence of scar in MRI. These are the things which tell you that you are dealing with hypertrophic cardiomyopathy, not athletic heart. I think I'm unable to move my slides.
Yes, doctor, just come to the left.
I think like, you know,
left corner of your screen, I think you'll find some arrows. Yes. When you come down. Left bottom corner.
Oh, okay.
To the bottom, you'll see there are right arrow over there. You can just click that. Yes.
Oh, okay, right. But even this is not, you know, moving it. Anyway, 2D strain can also help us to differentiate HCM from phenocopies, systemic hypertension, classically the basal segment which is involved. In Fabry's disease, it is the intralateral segment.
Doctor, I think it's exited the screen.
Yeah, can you go to the slide you are presenting, Dr. Shanmuga? I think you have gone back to the first slide.
Yes, doctor. I think you double-click the screen so it... you can just share it again. Yes.
Okay, I'll do this. I'm extremely sorry. I think you are able to see me now.
Yeah, we can see. Yes, but I think you have to move forward. You have to slide down.
Right. This is where I almost left. Sorry.
Yeah, make it full screen, please.
I think your network was a little bad, doctor. So, I mean, it's getting a bit stuck. So, I've just turned off your video, so it just plays a bit smoother.
I know. Yeah. I could get a message here. This is an example of amyloid where there is a hypertrophy of both LV and RV. Septum is hypertrophied. Valves look thicker. And poor systolic function, heart should alert you to the possibility of amyloid, because hypertrophic cardiomyopathy to develop systolic dysfunction, LV mass should regress generally. Apical sparing in 2D strain would also suggest that it could be amyloid. For some time, there was talk about identification of Fabry's disease in 2D echo based upon the binary sign. You can see a hyperreflectile endocardium, then comes a hypoechoic region, then the mid-myocardium again becoming hyperechoic. This is the so-called binary sign, which was believed to be a specific echo feature of Fabry's disease. But later studies failed to confirm this. This very well can occur in other causes of LVH, including hypertrophic cardiomyopathy. This illustration actually belongs to a patient with proven hypertrophic cardiomyopathy, not Fabry's disease. This belongs to a person with very severe hypertension and systolic dysfunction and heart failure. With adequate treatment, within few months of LV function regress, improved to near normalcy. This is way to differentiate systolic dysfunction simulating hypertrophic cardiomyopathy. People looked at various echo parameters which are likely to be helpful to differentiate HCM from amyloid and from hypertension. Only one parameter, namely the ratio between the ejection fraction strain, seems to differentiate these three conditions. The ratio is higher in cardiac amyloid, 5.5 in amyloid, 3.7 in HCM, and 3.2 in systemic hypertension. If you look at different categories, overall population, people with good EF, people with mild to moderate hypertrophy, the one which proves to be the best discriminator is the EF-SR ratio. But simply speaking, phenocopies are likely if there is symmetrical LVH, systolic dysfunction in the presence of hypertrophy. If somebody document progressive hypertrophy during your follow-up, this is unlikely to be due to HCM. Presence of pericardial effusion, thickening elsewhere, namely the valves and atrial septum. And as a clinician, you will be able to detect non-cardiac symptoms and signs suggestive of atrial diagnosis, yet another area where echocardiography and cardiac MRI would be useful. Even in people with no hypertrophy, cardiac MRI can, you know, detect the disease, confirm it with you know, gene studies by identifying abnormal mitral apparatus, occurrence of crypts, and you know, these scars by late gadolinium enhancement. I conclude that hypertrophic cardiomyopathy is a disease of diversity. Look for hypertrophy in unusual locations. A careful scanning from base to apex and short axis view would be able to identify most of the people with HCM. Rarely we need CMR to diagnose, but CMR is very essential in HCM for risk stratification. Document obstruction by provocative methods. Identify the level of obstruction. It is very essential for septal reduction therapies. Risk stratification is an important step. Make sure that these are all phenocopy, real, you know, hypertrophic cardiomyopathy. And it is an important responsibility of a clinician to screen the family members for various benefits. And cardiac MRI is definitely required for all with HCM. I would like to thank my technician who had given me you know, such an excellent images so that my talk, you know, made easier. Thank you very much for patient listening.
Thank you, Professor Shanmugasundaram. Indeed, I mean, it couldn't have been a more erudite presentation and a more informative presentation. I have personally learned a lot from your presentation, and it speaks volumes about your experience and grip on the subject. You are extremely senior, very revered cardiologist of the country, and your presentation testifies why you are. So thank you very much. So I am sure the members of the audience have also gained a lot and learned a lot from Professor Shanmugasundaram's presentation. And I am sure that we'll be having some interaction on the subject. I will set the ball rolling with my question. I mean, you have addressed almost all the phenotypes. And you have alluded to the phenotype I'm going to talk, but I want your brief comment on there is asymmetric posterior wall hypertrophy phenotype of HCM also. So do you have you come across such phenotypes in your vast career? And would you like to speak about that phenotype? Professor Shanmugasundaram, am I audible?
Yes, doctor, you're audible. I think doctor's network is just a bit choppy at the moment.
I'm able to hear you, Mitra Kumar. Yeah.
Doctor, I'll just turn off your video feed, doctor, so your audio is a bit clearer. I'll just do that for you.
Yeah, did you hear my question? I asked about a specific phenotype, asymmetric posterior wall hypertrophy. Have you come across any such case in your very vast career? And would you like to comment on this phenotype?
I think my internet connectivity is very poor. Are you able to hear me, Samitra Kumar?
Yes, now I can hear you, yes.
Yeah. Thing is, like, you know, I had only patients who presented with isolated hypertrophy of LV inferior wall and infralateral wall. A rare
surprise. I mean, what do you think would be the prognosis in such case? Do those patients have LVOT obstruction or SAM as well? And what is the symptomatology in such kind of patients?
Definitely, outflow obstruction is not going to happen because the region of hypertrophy is quite away from outflow. And regarding the prognosis, I'm not sure because, you know, my experience is
A review of literature surprised me. These patients are frequently very symptomatic from the early phase of their disease, and they are frequently refractory to medical therapy, and they also need surgical correction. But I'm yet to come across one such patient who is very symptomatic with only posterior wall hypertrophy and needing surgery. So, I mean, just for curiosity and addressing, the audience, making the audience aware about this phenotype also, I raise this question. My another comment is, you have mentioned 3D echo in terms of the various scallops of the anterior mitral leaflet and how actually one of the scallops prolapses, I mean, moves more than the other scallops, giving rise to the smiling dolphin appearance. But are there any other applications of 3D eco, which can give it an edge over 2D eco?
I mean, the 3D strain is another area. Even mid-cavity obstruction can be better documented. Even apical cardiomyopathy, apical aneurysm, you know, particularly can be well documented by 3D echo. But I don't do 3D, quite often. So I may not be able to answer the question, but my experience is mostly with 3D.
Actually, you rightly pointed out that most of the time, the window is fortunately very good in HCM patients. So transthoracic echo remains our mainstay, but literature is still evolving with 3D echo. So maybe in some patients, as you rightly pointed out, distribution of a hypertrophy or something known as mass dispersion index can be better highlighted by 3D echo. But it is still very fluid, and our mainstay is first of all 2D transthoracic echo, followed by cardiac MRI. I will read out some questions which are there on the chat box. Dr. Aurangzeb Sheikh has asked, in 2D echo, how to measure IVS and wall thickness? How do you identify the papillary muscle? This is a very basic question. Dr. Shanmuga, would you like to address this?
Yeah, I think now short axis view is the best view to measure thickness of various segments. And from base to apex slowly, freeze it in end diastole, exclude trabeculations and the papillary muscles and measure the thickness. That's the way it has to be done. Papillary muscles can easily be identified, and it can be separated from the true wall thickness.
Okay. Another question is that what is the cutoff gradient of LVOT to say it is high gradient? I think you have already answered it, more than 30 millimeters. Am I right, Dr. Shanmuga?
Yeah, truly so. But the question is quite valuable, because if somebody has a gradient of about 15, 18 millimeter of mercury at rest, if I'm able to provoke the gradient to 50 millimeter of mercury, it becomes significant. So I don't think we can, rule out obstructive cardiomyopathy by just resting gradient alone. So if you have somebody with hypertrophic cardiomyopathy, you need to do at least Valsalva maneuver to see whether there is any provocable gradient. I think more than the resting gradient, the provoked gradient is very important.
Okay. Professor Shahbaz wants to know the natural history of apical hypertrophic cardiomyopathy. Do you think that there is a difference from the Japanese variant of apical hypertrophic cardiomyopathy to what we see more often amongst Indians?
The pattern of hypertrophy is definitely different here. Majority of them seem to belong to mixed variety rather than the pure apical type. As I was mentioning in one of the presentations, the occurrence of scar in the apex, occurrence of documented aneurysm, occurrence of mid-cavity gradient, and documentation of paradoxical flow at the mid-cavity, these are all the pointers which tell us that we are dealing with high-risk apical cardiomyopathy. If we don't have or don't document any of them, apical cardiomyopathy is likely to have a good prognosis.
Okay. Professor Bishwaranjan Mishra wants to know, what is the importance of LV apical to basal septal muscle bundle encountered in routine 2D echo without significant hypertrophy?
A good question again. We get to see this apical basal septal muscle bundle in some normal individuals as well. I don't think we need to give any importance to this when there is no hypertrophy. But if you document this in one of the relatives of HCM, I think you need to give importance.
Okay, thank you. So question from Dr. Rajesh Roy. Is there any normal range for mid cavity gradient, or mere increase in the gradient with provocation should be considered as a positive finding?
Literature, there is no cutoff to say that there is mid cavity gradient, but I think we can extrapolate the same thing which we use for LV outflow gradients. For resting obstruction, 30 millimeter. For provocable gradient, even when there is no gradient or no turbulence at rest, you try to provoke the gradient by various maneuvers, and any gradient of 30 millimeter of mercury or more should be considered as significant.
Trying to figure out what are the best views to pick up apical and mid cavity gradients.
Obviously, apical four chamber view. Almost all individuals with this apical and mid cavity disease, you will be able to get the paradoxical flow. You'll be able to get the gradient from apical four chamber view. Very rarely I have seen when apical four chamber view is not helping us to document the presence of apical hypertrophy, apical two chamber has helped me, but it is only few occasions. But most of the occasions, apical four chamber view will be enough for anatomy as well as physiology.
Just trying to figure out whether I have missed any questions. So I think we have covered all the questions. We have also highlighted very nicely how to look for the subclinical hypertrophic cardiomyopathy, especially in the relations of the patient diagnosed with hypertrophic cardiomyopathy. Would you like to give some tips to the members of the audience as to how to proceed about this? Because they are often very apprehensive about the children developing the disease when they grow up.
Both ECG and echocardiography should be done for all family members of HCM proband. Remember that ECG may show abnormalities when echo is perfectly normal. So ECG is very important. It may document high voltage ST changes. So you should do an ECG. By echocardiography, apart from looking for the presence of hypertrophy, we need to identify the presence of diastolic function abnormality in the strain parameters, which may suggest that these are the individuals who are likely to be gene positive. So this is known as HCM without hypertrophy. Even mitral valve abnormalities, a long anterior mitral leaflet, big papillary muscle, bifid papillary muscle. These are the things which caution you that the family member is likely to have an abnormal gene, may develop the phenotype as well.
And Dr. Shanmugasundaram, how often do you do cardiac MRI in a patient of HCM? Do you do it routinely in all patients, or there are only specific subsets where you advise cardiac MRI?
Now, off late, for the last 1.5 years, I've been doing it in all with HCM because it offers much more information than what we get in echocardiography alone. Almost all I do get it, unless the capacity to bear the charges is not there, I insist on getting a HCM. MRI for HCM, all HCMs.
Another question about the thin filament mutations, because these patients often do not have the very striking kind of hypertrophy that a typical HCM patient has. So in the first place, when would you doubt that this patient may be suffering from this particular form of HCM, the thin filament mutations, which are more likely to progress to DCM later on?
I don't think there is any relationship between the phenotype and genotype. if you want to identify thin filament mutations, you may have to do a genetic study. I think there is no other way.
Okay. So would you doubt it when there is a bad family history and do further probing? If there is a history of unexplained death in the family or people progressing to DCM, but now presenting with a kind of a mild hypertrophy and low to normal EF, that kind of a patient?
Maybe, yes. I think that's a valid point.
Okay. So, Mr. Jordan, do you have any other questions in the chat box?
Oh, yes, doctor. I've sent you a few more.
Dr. Chandrasekhar from Mayo has commented that measuring the gradient from squatting to standing is a useful technique to measure the gradient. I think, you know.
Yes, I can see that. Yes. Yes, very, very valuable comment. He writes, the simple technique of measuring the gradient from squatting to standing up is useful at the time of imaging. It may provide gradient even in those where Valsalva did not. Dr. Chandrasekharan, if you are listening, I mean, do you think giving a sublingual nitrate can further unmask that kind of a gradient? I mean, I don't know. He may not be able to speak. But Dr. Samlokasundaram, what is your opinion?
I mean, it is generally discouraged. You know, there are occasions where nitrates had produced very severe obstruction resulting in cardiovascular collapse. You know, we need to resuscitate individuals. So I think, like, you know, the safest way is to either do a Valsalva maneuver or the squatting to standing or a physical exercise.
You did mention about the dobutamine stress echo. Would you advocate in a patient of HCM? I mean, we always talk of exercise stress echo. No. What is your opinion on dobutamine stress echo?
Dobutamine is not a good choice, I mentioned, because even in people without outflow obstruction, it can induce gradients.
So there is a question, if all parameters suggest normal diastolic function in apical variety, how should we interpret it?
I think, like, you know, I agree with you. There are certain patients in whom, if you use these four parameters, more than 50% being necessary to say there is diastolic dysfunction, quite often you will not be able to get all the four. You may be getting only three. And, you know, you may end up with only one being abnormal. But, you know, these are the situation where you should comment indeterminate diastolic function. So I think we have to accept our inability to assess diastolic function when we don't have at least two out of four.
There is a question, when there is a generalized hypertrophy, the person has to be now normotensive. How would you diagnose HCM in such a patient?
In a hypertensive individual?
No, normotensive individual with a concentric kind of a hypertrophy.
I think I should recall an instance where I had seen this patient way back in 1993. He had LVH, 12 millimeter, 13 millimeter concentric LVH, no hypertension, had dyslipidemia. He was prescribed a statin, regularly followed up. Few months ago when he came for review, I could a typical hypertrophic obstructive cardiomyopathy with the SAM and a resting gradient of about 70 millimeter of mercury. So whenever you have somebody with unexplained LVH, it is your responsibility to have a serial follow-up, at least with echocardiography, at least on an annual basis. This is maybe one instance, but it has alerted me that, you know, I should be very cautious in dealing people with unexplained LVH.
Okay. Dr. Chandrasekharan has added that we used to use amyl nitrate in the past. The mechanism is similar. Okay. Now, a very crucial question from Professor Sabaj. Would you allow a person with non-obstructive HCM to fly an aircraft?
I would rather find it difficult to answer this question. Can Chandrasekhar tell us something? Like, you know, he can always, you know, place his comments in the chat box.
Yeah. I hope when he says non-obstruct, he has tried all the maneuvers. I mean, the Valsalva, the exercise, stress testing, and even the squatting to standing change of posture that Professor Chandrasekharan has suggested. So, I mean, a truly non-obstructive HCM is a relatively better subset of HCM with a better prognosis. But I would tend to think that we should resort to cardiac MRI at least to rule out much of gadolinium late enhancement. What is your thought process? Still, Professor Chandrasekharan answers. Or maybe we have some opinion from the house.
I agree with you, Dr. Samitra Kumar, particularly when we have, you know, two pilots in the flight.
Yeah. Okay. So, I don't think there are other questions in the chat box. A final check. Yes, I think no more questions. I think Dr. Chandrasekharan has come up with something.
Dr. Anish Sharma has posted, he had seen two patients of apical variety who were allowed to fly the aircraft. Okay. And Dr. Chandrasekhar has commented that real-time 3D imaging of LV adds value in the easy detection of anomalous bundles associated with HCM, as well as its contribution to the gradient.
Good. Well, actually, our 3D learning curve is still on the upswing about HCM in particular. So probably in days to come, we'll learn more about the role of 3D echo beyond 2D transthoracic echo, particularly in hypertrophic cardiomyopathy. So if there are no further questions, thank you once again, Professor Shanmugasundaram. It was really a pleasure and a privilege on my side to be moderating this session. As I have already mentioned, I have personally learned a lot, and I'm sure the members of the audience would have also, learned a lot, and maybe is going to implement much of the information that you have passed on today to us in their day-to-day lives while treating HCM patients. So thank you everyone involved in organizing this very useful symposium on hypertrophic cardiomyopathy and its variants. And I think this will be another very well-remembered session in the webinar series of Indian Academy of Cardiology. So thank you, Professor Shanmugasundaram, and thank you everybody, all members of the audience, for your patient hearing and very active interaction in the discussion. Thank you very much.
Thank you, Dr. Samitra Kumar. Bye-bye.
Thank you, Dr. Azias. Bye-bye.